Welcome to this lecture on network psychometrics, a very quick introduction to network analysis and how you estimate networks from cross-sectional data. This is a guest lecture that I gave for a class in the University of Amsterdam psychological methods bachelor track or undergraduate track, which I recorded, except that I forgot to record the first 2 minutes of it. And I figured it might be a nice talk to just put on YouTube because it might be interesting to some people. So that's why I will quickly redo the first 2 minutes of the talk, and then at some point you'll see a cut, and then it will go on to the talk as I gave it in the class. So in this talk, I want to introduce the concept of network psychometrics or network modeling in psychology, which has grown to be quite a popular field of study where lots of people are working on it and are doing things with it. And the main idea behind this field stems from the network perspective of psychology, which is the idea that variables can influence each other, basically, which has been proposed about over 10 years ago by mainly Danny Worsbaum, Anseli Kramer, Hans van der Maas, and some others as well, which led to a big world of network psychometrics, which is the field of estimating network models from data. So I always like to introduce the background of this from this original network perspective, actually using the same sample that I've been using for a lot of time now, where we can see that variables in psychology that we measure, and these are now, let's say, symptoms. But it could be something else, like cognitive traits, like cognitive abilities, how well your math skills and your verbal reasoning skills, and like these little pictures that you put in the Raven, you know. Maybe like personality items or things like that. What we often see is that these tend to correlate positively with each other. And then we try to explain that behavior by using some sort of statistical modeling. And for 100 years, what we've been doing is we've been exposing this factor model. So, okay, these tend to be positive, but we can explain that because there is a latent variable causing the covariation between these items. In this case, that latent variable would be the depression. But you can also think of like general intelligence or any other kind of latent variable. And that usually also relies on this assumption that after controlling for this latent variable, the covariation between these items is no longer there, called local dependence. Now, one thing that we've been seeing for a very long time is that these latent variables have been proposed and used, and we try to measure something. But at the same time, we've never really found evidence for many of these latent variables to exist, which is quite a problematic thing. Like, we don't know what depression is. We don't know where it is in the brain, for example. We don't know what general intelligence is. We have some covariates with it, but that's about it. At the same time, also, this assumption of local independence is also not really that tenable, because you can think of a lot of ways in which it is violated. Like, regardless of your depression, if you have something like depression already, like if it exists, regardless of that level, you can think that these things tend to covary anyway, because like insomnia, if you're tired, you or you sleep bad, you will be tired. If you're tired, you might have concentration problems. And if you have concentration problems, you you might worry a lot. And if you worry a lot, you might sleep badly as well. So you can think of all kinds of links between these items, regardless of any level of depression, right? So latent variables are not really clear if they exist or not, and if they exist, we can still think of all kinds of relationships that might occur as well between these items. Danny Worsbaum and Anseli Kramer and others, they came up with the idea of, well, if that's true, why don't we just take it from the ground up and we start by modeling this kind of behavior between indicators directly and see if we can get anywhere without needing a latent variable, right? So maybe then you could actually explain that these items covary already by having these interactions between items directly without the need of imposing a latent variable. And this is where the network perspective came from. Like, okay, we can look at these things as networks or as systems or as complex systems, where the behavior of the system can be explained by these interactions between its elements itself, right? In this case, observed behaviors as well. And that's really like the where the idea came from to start thinking in terms of networks. And this allows for many other analogies to be taken to different fields as well. So we can draw a lot of analogies to other fields. So what I'd like to do is take a complete step back and then talk about something completely different, which is ecology, or in this case, lakes. So this is a picture of a lake, a shallow lake in the Netherlands. And this is a picture of a lake where things go well. Right, so we have a lake here, we have fishies, we have birds, there's like plants here, there's another fish, a big fish, there's some plants here, the water is nice and clear, things go well in this lake, right? It's a nice lake, you would want to swim in this lake maybe. And we can measure actually a lot of things about this lake as well, right? So we can measure these kinds of things, like are there birds, are there plants, is the water clear? Is oxygen in the water? Is it a habitable behavior environment there? Things like that. Now, here's another picture of another lake. And this is a lake where things are not going well, right? So the water is very dirty. There are no plants anymore. The fish are sort of like being depressed, bumping their head to the floor. I guess they're just trying to get the only food which is on the floor here. I guess there's still plants, but this fish is sort of awkwardly looking away rather than at a nice thing. This bird is thinking, I'm going to go somewhere else. Like the things we can measure here are bad in general, right? If we measured, and this might actually be not in the different lake, it might also be the same lake at a later time point. And that's something that happens in ecology. Like these lakes, they go through phase transitions as well. So sometimes they're good, sometimes they're bad. And that's actually a thing that ecologists try to explain. Like how did this nice little lake in the Netherlands became a dirty lake a bit later? So the things that you measure here are also correlated, right? So the clarity of the water, the oxygen in the water, the amount of fish, the amount of life. And if you look at these two lakes, they tend to be also positively correlated, right? So if one thing goes well, other things goes well. If this goes bad, other things go bad. That tends to be a thing not only in psychology, but in other things as well. Now, if we then, as psychologists, come to the ecologist and tell the ecologist, well, we can solve your problem. We understand this perfectly because this is a latent variable model. We know that because that's how we explain positive correlations. Then the ecologist would look at us rather confused and send us home, right? Because there's not really a latent variable causing generable lake wellness or something like that, right? The ecologists have a very different explanation for that, and that is that all these things influence each other, right? In this lake, it goes well here because there are plants, there are fish, and there are fish because there are plants, right? The fish helps like reproducing the plants, the plants give food to the fish. Also, the plants make the water clearer, which also makes the environment better and things like that, right? Because of their fish, there are birds, because there's food, I guess. All these things interact with each other in a complex way. And this is what ecologists call the mutualism model, right? And that you can also think of as a network, right? You can also represent all these things as nodes that are interacting and mutually beneficially enforcing each other. Which is a completely different viewpoint that you can take on these kinds of behavior. Well, we can do the same thing, of course, also with depression, for example, or with intelligence. You can also see intelligence as a system that evolves over time, where these abilities mutually enforce each other. So that's the idea of Hans van der Maas' paper from 2006, where he applied the mutualism model to intelligence. And that's actually the first network paper as well, really. And the idea there was to really try to understand intelligence from this mutualism point of view, where like, okay, I have good reading skills as a child, I can more easily read my things, I can also more easily learn other things, you can develop other skills well more easily. It all benefits each other, basically. So that's an analogy you can take. Another completely different analogy is the one from thermomagnetism, which is called the Ising model. And there, they are concerned with, for example, a plate of iron. Right? So this might be a plate of iron. And that plate of iron consists of particles. And a particle is basically like a small magnet. It has a north pole and a south pole. And that simplified things, they're only like at a square plate next to each other. And they only have like the north pole is either pointing up or it's pointing down. So it could also be like sideways and stuff. But let's say it's only in two states. Then magnets tend to align. So that's actually how a compass works, right? Like the Earth's a big magnet, the compass is a small magnet, and they want to be in the same alignment, basically. And that also happens in like plates of iron or anything. So that means that, let's say, this magnet here wants to be aligned with this magnet. But at the same time, this magnet also wants to be aligned with that magnet. So there's actually a mutual reinforcing system here as well. So if the north side is pointing up here, then this one has the north side pointing up. But if this one has the south side pointing up, then this one has the south side pointing up. Which is an interesting system, and you can model that as well. So how they model that is with a network model. You represent every variable here as a node, which you encode like 1 meaning north side points up, minus 1 meaning south side points up. And then you model that this increases the probability of that going up, and that increases the probability of this going up. And then you can also simulate data under that, and then you get all kinds of interesting behavior. Like one thing you can have is that every node basically goes on, or every particle turns to the same direction, which is what we call magnetism. You can also have phase decisions in that. You can also see that something gets like really stuck in one state, things like that. And you can also have like some sort of self-organized system where like you get like these kind of clusters in here where these are all on and these are all off, basically. Now, if you take an analogy here with like symptoms, for example, you can also see that these symptoms can tend to like keep each other constant. Like my depressed symptom, my depressed mood, my insomnia can keep other symptoms from depression constant, like sleeping badly or like being irritated or things like that. A nice thing about this easing model is that you can also think of it in terms of intervention. So I could intervene on, let's say, this. Clear all my ink again, that I could intervene on, say, this node here, and that would cause actually that one to be flipped. So I could go into my plate of iron and switch a particle, and that would cause this one to be flipped. But on the other hand, I can also intervene here, and that would cause that one to be flipped. So there's actually some really interesting mutual beneficial relationships here in this model as well. A final analogy that I want to show is basically virus spread models. Those became relevant now as well. And this is a model where we took the DSM structure. So we have the two clusters here for like depression and generalized anxiety disorder. And we simply drew like these are symptoms. And we drew like, and there's some other like things around it as well. We drew basically the system where each symptom is connected to another symptom if they're in the same disorder. And then we got all the depression, anxiety symptoms, but also all the peripheral symptoms of that. So the one layer of connections to that. So you have like some disorders here, for example, as well. And then what we did then is we simply modeled a virus spread model, just like the coronavirus. But then where you don't get immunity, you get reinfected. That's the idea. And you also have a random chance of getting infected as well. So these red nodes, they are infected. The white nodes are not infected, and you can also say that there's a symptom being active and a symptom being not active. So if you simulate that, like this goes pretty well for most cases, but so normally like the person is like feeling okay with some symptoms, but now, completely random actually, we got this cluster that started to activate where all symptoms are activated at the same time. And that is behavior that you can have in these kinds of network models where you have that, let's say this whole cluster now went on, which you could see as a as like a disorder, right? Where multiple symptoms are on. Even though we did not necessarily put in a disorder, or we did not put in that person would like get all these symptoms at this time point. A very simple simulation that led to us also thinking, hey, this might be a nice approach to this. So that's basically the background behind why we're doing networks. And like 10 years ago, we were looking at these kinds of models and thinking, yeah, this might make sense for psychology as well. Then one problem that we have is like, okay, here we constructed a network, let's say, of a book, right? So we drew links between symptoms if they made sense according to the book. Here the symptoms are, or the nodes are placed next to each other because they're on a plate of iron, basically. But in generally, we don't really know what network structure we should expect in psychology. So a big problem that we had is that we don't have observable networks, right? We can't ask symptoms what other symptoms are you related to. We can't ask cognitive traits what other cognitive traits you're related to, etc. So instead, we need to estimate this somehow. And preferably, we would like to estimate it from the data we have, which is like the self-report data that you pretty much always use in psychology as well. So ideally, you would like to have some method of getting a network structure from that. And that has been, so basically, like we have data and we want to go to a network. Right? So that has been a big problem that I've been working on mainly in the past years, where I did my PhD on as well, which resulted in this book, where we developed a lot of methods, not only me, but a lot of other people that we work with as well in the group. We developed a lot of methods that allow you to do this from all kinds of data sets. So this, for example, is a network that you estimated from cross-sectional data. And this I'll explain a bit more in detail how you can estimate that. Every node in here is then a variable. And in this case, these are personality items. So these are items like, do you like to go to parties? Do you like people? Right? Do you like children? Things like that. Right? The big five personality traits. And then these links here, a blue link indicates a positive effect. So this is like positive, and the red link indicates a negative effect. And sometimes you'll see like green instead of blue. Like at first we use green and red, but then it turns out that's not good for colorblind people. So we change it to blue. So this link here indicates the conditional association between two items after parsing out a conditioning on all other variables in the network. So basically the association is left after you control for everything that you can control for. That's the general rough idea. And then we also developed methods where you can estimate this from like time series data as well, which I'll talk a bit about later, if I have time. Where you can get like a network per person, for example, and also get some insight over things that might be occurring over time rather than in the same time point. Now, a very important aspect that we have that you don't really see in the complexity world, it's in other fields, is that we really have to be very careful about the uncertainty of our parameters as well. So we know we estimate these models, and we know that with any estimation procedure, you get sampling variation and sampling error, right? That's just literally why we do significance testing, for example, because the mean itself is not enough, right? We need to see what variance you have around that mean to make any inference. And I think that's really a part where we as a field distinguish ourselves from people that do networks in other fields. Even though they might also need to do that. So we look a lot at like these uncertainties as well, like we bootstrap that and get like an interval around that, or we use some statistical methods to compare networks or to compare parameters or see if a parameter is zero or not, things like that. In many other fields, actually, you see that people just use some random method to generate a network and are not really concerned with this level of certainty, which is kind of weird as well. Like brain networks, for example, you see quite a lot of variability in there. You see like people that use very good methods and also people that just like do anything. So this is something that we do a lot, where we also look at the uncertainty of the parameters and see if it is a network stable. Would you get the same results if you get a new data set? Are differences in the structure, because the network itself, like this is just a function of the data set, it could look different because that's what sampling variation is. Are the differences, are they meaningful or not? Like, are they substantial or not? Between groups, things like that. So for that, we use like a lot of resampling methods or significance testing or like Bayesian sampling methods and things like that. And that's really the core of the estimation in two slides. And that has been applied now quite a lot. So this became quite a popular thing, actually, where many people have been applying this set of methodology to anything, really. So we see a lot of clinical applications in clinical psychology, where this became quite a big hit. And that's also because of Danny Borsbaum's more theoretical work on this network perspective for clinical disorders, right? But it's not only in clinical psychology that this is used. We also see it used in quite a lot of other fields. Like this is actually one of the first applications I did is where we took, where we looked at this red node here, which is intention to vaccine for something. What was it again? HBM. And then we looked at like motivations for taking a vaccine or not. And then you can see like, okay, that is like, this is, can I see? This is like these surrounding variables that are connected to it. Those are very highly predictive of this node. But then you can also see what predict that. So you see a pathway of prediction, which is basically highlighting mediation and multicollinearity in a nice way. That was a nice application, already quite old. And then many other people did like many other applications as well. One particular application is also nice, it's not on here, is the attitude models, where the networks are used to describe attitudes. Like, do you like Trump? Do you think he's a good president? Do you think he's a good person? People tend to have correlated responses to that as well. And you can map that out in a, in an attitude as well, actually. And then actually use that for prediction in like the election as well. Not Trump, but Jan Stelegger worked a bit on that for other elections as well. So like really general application we see it in, which is nice. Okay, so then I want to talk a bit about these net models so that you have a bit of a rough understanding on what they are and how you estimate them. Now, if you do the research master next year or the PDS master, you can follow this course called Network Analysis as well, where this is explained in much more detail. And also have some links at the end of the slides where you can also learn a bit more if you want to. So I'll just do some very brief introduction to it. So the main network models that we use are these undirected models, where we have no direction. So we don't have an arrow here. There are also methods that try to discover directed models. So they try to discover like directionality in your network as well, like A causes B perhaps. The downside of those things is that they are very hard. They rely on the more strong assumptions, like that A can cause B, but B cannot cause A, which is not really very plausible because you can assume that these things might mutually beneficially influence each other as well. And the algorithms are also much harder to use. And the pictures are also much less clear. So we tend to steer away from that and actually use these undirected network models, which are really nice models that are much clearer and also better visualized. And like you always get the same picture, basically. That's also a nice thing. They're uniquely identified as well. Now, there are many different types. These are called Markov random fields. That's a more statistical term for that. Or actually pairwise Markov random fields. And depending on your data source, there are many different types that you can use. Then the main two that we use are Ising models for binary data and Gaussian graphical models for Gaussian data or continuous data. The Gaussian graphical model is also called a partial correlation network. That's what you see more often in papers. And the Ising model actually has some different names as well, like it's basically a log linear model. I think some people call it a quadratic model as well. It's like it has some different names as well, but we like to call it an Ising model. These are the main two we use, and then we also use something called mixed graphical models if you have a combination of these, which is from Jonas as well. And then there's some other models that also fall in this class, but I want you to talk about them. And the idea behind all these models is that edges show conditional independence. So this S shows the strength of a relationship between these two items after taking all other variables into account. So in the partial, the GGM, that's actually is partial correlation. So this is literally the strength of the partial correlation between two items after conditioning on everything else, which is between minus one and one. And it's basically correlation coefficient, but then controlled for everything else. Yeah, and these things have some really nice properties, like uniquely identified, that might not mean much yet, but it's actually a really nice thing to have. Like basically, you don't have two equivalent models, right? Like if in the direct model you have A, B, and A, arrow B, these are the same model. So you cannot distinguish between them. It's not an identified model. So if you have a data set, if this model fits well, then automatically this model also fits well. You never know which one is the best one. But you don't have that problem here, because here you would just get like a one arrow B, which is nicer. And you can make like a nice weighted picks as well. All right. Now, as I said, it's became quite popular. So quite a lot of people use it already. This review paper from 2019, let's look at until 2018. And they show that, like, especially in this cross-sectional analysis world, people use a lot of these Markov random fields. Like this square here is in the circle here. This is the Markov random field. And this stability analysis basically means that we also used the bootstrapping and looked at, like, how stable the results are, which is a good thing, right? So most people did this, basically. And time series analysis started coming up as well, became also quite popular as well. Not as big yet as this cross-sectional world. It's also harder, right? You have less of these data sets. All right, so how do you estimate something like this? Basically, there are roughly two methods to do it. There are actually many methods to do it, but I'll roughly categorize them in two. One is multivariate estimation, which means that you estimate all the parameters at once. So that you have a network, you estimate, let's say you have a network like this, with edges. I estimate them all at once. Yeah. So for that, you need to have a multivariate distribution, which is an expression that requires matrix algebra as well. So, like, a univariate distribution is like, for example, this, right? A normal distribution, but a multivariate one has, like, it's like a 3D picture, you know, for like two variables. And then if it's three or four variables, it becomes like a four or five dimensional picture. It's more complicated than the univariate one. And these methods typically rely on what we call the likelihood, which is, well, you probably heard of that term before, right? Likelihood. It's the distribution of the data. So basically, how likely is your data according to the parameters? The second method is univariate estimation. And what we there do is we actually split this problem up in only estimating edges per node. So we only estimate, for example, the edges for node 1. And then we estimate the edges for node 2. And then we combine them all afterwards in the picture. But basically, this is a series of univariate estimations. When univariate means one variable, so then we only have one distribution, basically. So this is much simpler, but it's you require more analysis. So where this is, like, for say 10 nodes, this is one analysis, this is 10 analysis. And then you combine the results and make the picture. They should lead to a similar result, but it's a very different approach to take it. I generally like the multivariate estimation routine because you do everything in the same model and you get, like, fit indices as well, perhaps. But the univariate one is more flexible and more easy to do. And sometimes you can use it where the multivariate one is not possible. So that's a nice thing about that. Both methods allow for what I call constrained and unconstrained estimation. Basically, unconstrained estimation would be you include all the edges in the network, where constrained estimation means that you set some edges to be equal to zero. So you estimate the structure rating. No, I want this model to fit. I don't care about this edge. I want it to be zero. I want to see what these edge weights are without that edge. And you can do that as well. Right, so this one might not be significant, for example, then we remove it. All right, so multivariate estimation. This relies on the joint likelihood. So that means that you need a model that gives you how likely are the data to occur. And then we pick the parameters under which the data were most likely to occur. Right? So let's say I have a coin. Yeah, like a coin. Is that a euro sign? No, that's not a euro sign. This is a euro sign, right? A coin. And I flip it. And let's say I flip it like 100 times and I get... 50 heads, yeah. I could, and then I want to estimate the probability that that coin lands on the heads. Then I could say, okay, I have, let's say, a graph here, let's say for pi, and then I could say, okay, 0.50 here. And that might look like this likelihood function. And then I want, okay, I'll pick this point here, this estimate for pi, which is a 0.50, because the data was most likely to occur if the coin was fair, right? That's the idea of maximum likelihood estimation. And we can do the exact same principle for many parameters with a joint distribution as well. It's the same thing, actually. The equations are a bit less nice. So this is the equation for the normal distribution, the multivariate normal distribution, which basically has like this covariance matrix here and a mean factor here. You can find some Wikipedia. And for the Ising model, it looks like this, both have this E here, this Euler constant, which is like 2.7. Udo probably knows that. 2 point something. So that there is a reason for that. They're actually very similar models. Actually, you can write them as the same model if you disregard this part here and this part here, which are the constants, and then you can actually write this expression as that as well, almost. So they're almost the same model as well. All right, node-wise estimation. So basically, then you just optimize this like you would do the probability of landing on head. You can do that by like forming a derivative and setting it to zero. That's all pretty complicated, so I won't go into detail. Like expressions get a bit ugly at some point, but there's basically algorithms that do this for you that basically just choose parameters under which this was gets an optimum. Node-wise estimation, that makes use of the fact that these models have very nice univariate distribution, marginal distributions. Thus, basically, this model implies that the distribution of each node, given all other variables, takes the form of a linear regression model, which is quite a magical thing, or a logistic regression model for the Ising model. That basically means that we can just run a linear regression or a logistic regression with one dependent variable and many independent variables per variable to get the same parameter estimates for the edges. So that makes things actually really easy. I'll the set that you can ignore now. So this is actually another common way of estimating the models. So also a nice way to interpret them, actually. So basically, if you have a network and we want to estimate the edges, what we could do is we have here y1, right? The dependent variable, let's say. And we want to see the edges, how that relates to y2, y3, and y4. We can just run a linear regression, like this LM in R. You can even do it like in SPSS. It's just a normal regression model with like three predictors and one dependent variable. Then we get like some coefficients. These are just the slopes, right? The regression coefficients. And then we do the same for the second variable, for the third variable, and for the fourth variable. So we just run four times a linear regression model with different dependent variable and different independent variables. Right, the dependent variable is like y2, and the independent variables are everything but y2. Now everything but y3. We do that, we get a lot of regression coefficients, and turns out that these are very similar to each other. Actually, if one is significant, the other is significant, usually. Then it also turns out that we can actually standardize them to these partial correlation coefficients, which is quite magical, because like the regression coefficient of predicting like this one here that predicts y1 from y2, and this one here predicts y2 from y1, they're in different models, but they actually encode the same information, which is this partial correlation coefficient, which is really cool, right? That's really cool, actually, that it's possible, which you can also get from multivariate estimations. That's nice. That's really the gist, and that's the software that people use for this network analysis. Just do this, basically. All right, so you also want to work on it, and this is just what's being done usually, depending on the software. So there's actually many software packages that do estimation, and they're all taking a different approach in that. Like some do the univariate approach, some do the multivariate approach, some only estimate all edges, some estimate like some sort of constraint model, where some edges set to zero, and it's all... I won't really go into detail now, but there's many software now developed for this, and if you implement a new algorithm also, you can take another approach in it as well. And then actually the largest question is usually not really how to estimate these parameters, but how to select the model, which means which of these edges do you set to zero and which not. So like here, for example, we've set an edge to zero. And there are different approaches you can take for that as well. One would be to simply remove every edge that's not significant, which is a very crude approach, but it works. Another is to use like machine learning algorithms to shrink edges to zero and at the same time estimate the parameters, like lasso regularization, which is a very nice approach and also works. And you can also do stepwise model search, and like we start with like a full model, and then we remove some edges, and then we step from here, like here, for example, by adding edges again, and then we stop. That's also a way to do it. There are many different ways to do this. Now, the code is really easy to do this. So I'm actually preparing a short exercise for that as well. I haven't finished it yet, but I'll send it to Udo like tonight or tomorrow morning, where you can just do this yourself. I have a data set on symptoms from COVID-19 hospitalized patient in Wuhan, China, actually. And then you can make a network. And it's really easy to do. So basically, you load this package, bootnet, that we wrote. And this has one function called estimate network. And this estimate network is actually not a function that does anything. It's a wrapper around other functions, just to have, like, you have like a ton of RPACs that all estimate a network with different syntax. So what we did is we just made one function that makes that the same syntax, which makes it easier. So you just say data, and then you say default, and default is give some name, like pcore or EBSCG lasso or DGM mod select or MCM, like anything. And that will estimate a model for you in a different way. And then you can even do the stability analysis that I briefly showed, and I compare networks statistically as well with just a few lines of code. So this actually, this whole page explains network analysis, how to do it in practice. Well, there are a few more steps. Usually, getting the data in the right shape is like quite evolved, but that's it. That's the one way to do it, at least. There are other ways which are more complicated as well. But yeah, so if you're more interested in that, there are some tutorial papers out that you can read where it explains a bit more in detail these codes and stuff that you can use for that. All right. So then I'll skip most of the state-of-the-art future directions. Basically, I talk about cross-sectional data, but actually a lot of research doing this from time series data, right? So you have like these apps that you can give like a patient, and then you can measure that patient like 50 times, and that gives a time series, and then that gives net data that we can also use to estimate a network. They are more complicated networks. So you get like these network fields of temporal effects. There are more parameters, and you have less data, so that's actually quite hard of a problem. So they have to be really small, like only a few nodes, but then it is doable. There's a lot of people that do this as well. There's a lot of research about latent variables and how they relate to networks. So basically, if you have a latent variable model, that would actually imply a network model as well. Like you get a cluster for each latent variable. Then there's research that uses that fact to actually use networks for latent variable modeling, which is quite fun. So this paper here, what they do is they try to find clusters in the network and then say, oh, these are your latent variables. So it's basically like a full circle, because we started by saying, okay, you don't do latent variables anymore, do networks, and now we're back at latent variables. That's also my main line of research, actually, like combining these models. So what I do is I draw like networks between latent variables, for example. So these are networks between latent variables over time. So there's like a network model here. So these are latent variable models, sorry, and these are like the latents here. And then how they relate to each other over time. So that's one thing I've been working on a lot in this package called Psychonetrics. Jonas has done like a ton of stuff about extensions in network modeling, like time varying modeling, moderated networks, mixed graphical models, a lot. There's this ongoing debate between frequentism and Bayesianism that you might have heard of. I am the frequentist. I work on this package called Psychonetrics, which does frequentist analysis in the more proper way that we're supposed to do it, like SEM. But you also have like a really nice Bayesian approach to network as well, which you can estimate Bayesian, like network in a Bayesian way, which is also a very, very promising approach that is like become a big thing now as well. We did meta-analysis. So there are so many studies published now that we can actually start doing meta-analysis on this. So this is like 52 samples that we tried to aggregate into one model. So this is like the aggregated model of PTSD symptoms. And this is what I said, basically, you see these links you see like all the time. Also in individual studies, you see the same links like internal avoidance, external avoidance, easily started and hypervigilant. That kind of makes sense that these things connect to each other. Adaptive testing, I'll skip that, but basically you can do adaptive testing. That's what I'm trying to work on now. And then if you want to learn more, I have a website on the Psychonetrics package, which is the RPACs that I'm working on now, which is basically a big package that has like a ton of models in there that allow you to estimate these things and do multi-group comparison and get like significance tests and standard errors, things like that. There's a website about that if you want to learn more about that. There's also a website for the lab group of Danny Borsman, which is like the more higher level lab group that all these lower level projects are embedded in, which is more like our general network group, basically. So if you're interested in that, you can read up more about it on this website. One particular aspect of that website is this link here, which is to materials from our latest summer school. We gave a summer school online in June, and we recorded everything, so you can actually see that now. Yeah. Still, if you're interested in that, or go to the materials if you want to learn more. There's this blog from Eiko Fried about psychological networks. We have a big Facebook community, like a big group, like 3,000-4,000 people in there, where there's a lot of discussion about this as well, which is nice. We have a Center for Urban Mental Health, which started last year, which is a big multidisciplinary collaboration where people are also doing like complexity approaches to mental health research, which is nice, which is officially embedded in this Institute for Advanced Study, which is a beautiful beautiful center that we have in the center of Amsterdam where we can go to, except now, because now we're on Zoom, right? But normally we can go here as well, hopefully soon again. All right, that's it.